So I wanted to ask you, when you first started the project, to think about the communications that really have become the internet, what were your goals? What were you all hoping to achieve at that point?
At that point, we remember we had a fair amount of experience with something called the ARPANET, which was the predecessor network. It demonstrated the utility and effectiveness of packet switching in a heterogeneous environment where multiple computers with different operating systems were able to communicate over a homogeneous network. The internet was a step beyond that to include heterogeneous packet switching networks, radio-based, satellite-based, optical fiber-based, well, that came later, and so on. Then the question was, can we build this arbitrarily large network of networks linking a whole bunch of heterogeneous systems together? And so that was our initial objective. We knew that this was going to be useful for command and control. And so we incorporated into our thinking the need for mobile operation, for voice and video, and for security. So that was all part of the general framework in which this development took place.
When you were first building, did you imagine something as big as what we call the internet today?
Well, one argument is yes, because we were worried about the address space, for one thing. We did a calculation and we came to the conclusion in 1973 that we needed 4.3 billion terminations on this network. Now, for a small-scale experiment with only three or four networks at that time, that was a pretty ambitious goal, but we wanted this to be expandable. We knew it had to operate on a global scale because the military has to operate on a global scale.
So when you were thinking about security, what kinds of conversations occurred at that time?
So we have this military context in mind, and we know that we're going to have to secure the communications end to end because we're going to be going through a variety of networks, some of which might not be internally secured at all. So end-to-end crypto is important. The ability to route traffic arbitrarily through networks that might not be secured was important. So we knew all of that. And when we had this other problem, which is packet crypto, which didn't exist at the time, continuous line encrypting was common. But packet crypto, where you have to essentially decrypt things out of order, was a new thing, and that caused all kinds of hard work to happen. We had a whole program for developing packet cryptography. So that was all part of our model. The other part of the model, though, was that every device that was on the internet would have to defend itself. We didn't have any notion of perimeter. We didn't really have a notion of firewall. Every device was out on its own. That meant that if it received traffic, it had to decide, am I going to respond to this or not? And so we had to have strong authentication as part of the notion in the design of the system.
The internet and innovation are really synonymous. You were thinking back in the 70s about the breadth and the scale with the architecture and the design and people to be able to work on it. Where do you see innovation today? Where do you see not just the internet going, but where do you see innovations going that have an effect on the internet?
Well, let's start with the internet environment just as an example. In the case of internet, one thing we very carefully thought our way through is that the internet protocol layer has the characteristic that the packets don't know how they're being carried. That was an important ignorance. And they don't know what they're carrying. It's kind of like postcards that don't know how they were transported and they don't know what's written on them. This stupidity, this ignorance, turns out to be the key to innovation. As new transmission technology came along, the packets could be carried on anything. So when optical fiber became common, we just put the packet switching system on top of that. Similarly, when people had new ideas for applications, all they had to do was to put them on the net. We didn't change the network because all the network knew is it's switching packets around containing opaque content. So that ignites opportunity for innovation. But there's more to it than that, especially if you go out into the private sector. Innovation generally requires taking risk. That could be a startup, which is risky, or it could be an established company trying something out that might not work. Unless you have an environment where you're permitted to try things out and fail, you have no likelihood of true innovation. So innovation is happening all around the world. The internet contributes to it in part because of its architecture, but it requires, I would say, a business attitude of willingness to take risk. That's why Silicon Valley is so innovative, because the venture capital guys are willing to take risk and they know that some 80% of their investments may fail. So that's part of the story. You have to let people try stuff out. And the higher they shoot, the better. They may not get to that target, but you know, who wants a 10% increase when you could probably get 50, 60, 10x?
So as you're thinking about those kinds of innovation and the great platform of the internet to build on and as kind of that creative tool that allows you to think out, where do you see things going?
Well, one thing we can see is new platforms keep coming along. Let's take mobile as an example. Marty Cooper developed the handheld mobile in 1973. It didn't see the light of day until 1983. Ironically, that's exactly the decade when Bob Kahn and I started the internet, and it got turned on in January of 83. But those two technologies didn't quite join each other until 2007, when Steve Jobs came along with the iPhone and caught everybody's attention. Now, two things happened there. Both of these technologies became mutually reinforcing. The mobile gave you access to the internet instead of having to be in a fixed location. It could be anywhere. And the second thing is that the mobile had access to all the computing power and content of the internet. So these two things are mutually reinforcing. The second thing is that the mobiles worked this in a way similar to the way the internet protocol layer does. This API, this application programming interface in the mobile, means if you're writing an application, you don't actually have to know how the mobile part works. All you have to know is if you meet this interface, then your application should work. It sends and receives data from the assets of the internet. So this platform-like idea and this layering of protocols induces a great deal of creativity. The World Wide Web being a perfect example of that. The internet is this platform. World Wide Web is some more layers of protocol, HTTP, HTML, and so on. People have been building all kinds of applications on top of that infrastructure. And so you can see this repeat over and over again of invention where new platforms come along, inviting people to try out new applications.
Where do you see the big security challenges and how are they being addressed?
So it's not just security. When you think about the devices that we're using, when we hear this phrase, Internet of Things, appliances at the house, in the office, in the car that we carry, on our persons or even in our persons. So let's imagine all these appliances everywhere, full of software. We want them to be A, reliable, B, safe, 3, secure, 4, private, interoperable,
resilient.
Yes, resilient, all of those things. So we're really talking about software reliability and resilience and safety and everything else, because what animates all of these devices is software. The hardware is there because you have to have it to execute software, but it's the animation part that's important. And that's the thing which is the most troubling, because in the 70 years or so where we have been programming, we haven't figured out how to write software that doesn't have bugs. We don't even have environments for software creation that reduces the level at which we make mistakes. So that's the most serious concern I have. Security is part of that because bugs get exploited and the system gets penetrated and some bad thing happens, that's insecure. But there's more to it than just security. It's all the other reliabilities and things that we should worry about. So we should be really concerned about this because our world is going to be filled with software running all the time.
How do we improve software quality, which is, a fundamental question to, we can't afford to continue to play whack-a-mole with vulnerabilities. So how do we create an environment where we do have quality in software that's a requirement and expectation?
So there are pieces of the problem. I'm not sure I can parse it completely. One of them is creation of software that has fewer bugs. Another one is detecting bugs when they happen and finding ways to fix them. A third one is trying to deal with the fact that software, even when it works correctly, it may not work all the time. There are situations where the software didn't know what to, encounters a state that it wasn't expecting. You could call that a bug, but the idea here is that we need resilience in these systems. We need backup. We need the ability of the system to operate even when things are broken. You almost want something kind of sitting on your shoulder, watching while you're writing the code, saying, excuse me, but you just created a buffer overflow there. Or you might want to be able to say to the environment that's supporting your software work, can you find any places where I've used a variable that hasn't already been set? So otherwise I'm getting a random value and branching off into cyberspace somewhere.
What kind of advice would you give somebody who's just coming into this field?
The thing that I would want kids to understand as early as possible is that when they're trying to design software, they have to cover all the cases that they can possibly think of that might be that software might be confronted by. What that means is deliberate attack, which, by the way, we didn't pay a lot of attention to in the original internet design. We're all a bunch of engineers, and we expected, you know, our job was to get the system to work, not to wreck it. So we were focused mostly on how do we get this to work. Now, of course, because of the, you know, broad deployment, there are bad guys out there that want to interfere with the system. They want to harm you or somebody else. So we have to think our way through all of that. So these kids have got to know how to write software, which means they have to learn how to break down problems and solve, you know, smaller pieces and then put the pieces back together in an architecture that works. But we also have to expect them to deliberately ask themselves, how would I attack this system? How would I destroy its integrity? How would I interfere with its operation? Right. And some people don't agree with me, but I think kids should learn how to write malware, how to write it, not just to study it, but actually how to write it. They should experience what the bad guy does in order to interfere with secure operation or safe operation. And until you have thought your way through how you would attack the system, you don't really understand how you're going to defend it. And so some people say, well, you're creating a bunch of hackers. And my reaction to that is, no, I'm creating a bunch of people who know how hackers work. And so that's part of the story, I think, if we want software in the future to be more reliable than it is today.
What changes do you see in the networking space?
Well, there is a security issue here, which I think is of some interest. For a period of time, we actually used hardware as part of the security infrastructure. And then we sort of got distracted into the software space and focused mostly on software and its resilience. The thing is that we can use hardware to reinforce software security.
Yes.
And I like this a lot. I like the idea of the boot phase, checking a checksum or, you know, a digital signature to make sure that the software you're about to boot up is in fact valid, or at least somebody thinks it's valid. Mm-hmm. So there's a partnership that we should be exploiting, which I think we have not exploited much. And that is an area worthy of attention. So now let's go to try to answer your other question, which is what's happening in this space. I think there are trends that we can identify, and they're pretty obvious. One of them is increasing amounts of radio-based communication. Devices that are scattered around in our environment will use radio rather than wires for many of their applications. The second one is speed. We're seeing increasing amounts of data rate, whether it's optical fiber or higher frequencies and things like that. The third thing in the radio space is an increased attention to cohabitation in common bands. And this is a good thing because it allows us to make better use of the radio resources, but it also puts challenges in front of us because there's potential for interference. So we have to be smart about how we modulate the signal and maybe even dynamically do that. So those trends are very clear. The other one, which is pretty obvious, is the population of sensors and control systems that will be part of our daily lives, whether it's in the very virtual environment where you have intelligent assistants that respond to voice commands, you know, put this on the calendar, make a reservation to go to San Francisco, and having the system actually behave properly, all the way down to things that are security systems in the house, you know, sensing whether the windows are open or closed or controlling the environment. All of those things are going to be part of our world. And we need for the people who live in that world to appreciate first that we don't know how to guarantee everything. So you should anticipate things might not work. And second, we have to help people understand how to make it work better, okay, given this potential complexity of interaction among these devices that never met each other until you pull them into your house. Another thing which I worry about in this cyber-physical space is scaling. And imagine, just to make this, you know, sort of in human proportions, you have a house with 100 things in it, and you've carefully configured them so your house is behaving the way you want it to. You
so
know,
do I need an engineering degree to do that?
Well,
are we
hope
gonna
not.
Think about usability there for the average?
Well, let's pretend for a moment that somehow or other, whether you hired an engineer, the house is working at 100 devices, everything's cool, and then you move. and you move into a house that has another 100 devices in it, then you bring your other gadgets with you, and suddenly you're confronted with getting all that stuff to configure properly. You don't want to spend the entire week typing IPv6 addresses into some control program. You don't want the 15-year-old next door to notice you're in configuration mode and grab control over your entertainment system. You don't want to accidentally grab control over your neighbor's systems as well. This configuration and management thing is really tough. And finally, think about devices that are going to be installed for years, maybe decades. Think about water heaters and other major appliances. You don't swap those out at the same rate we swap out mobiles. What that means is that if the software that's animating them has a bug and it needs to be fixed, how do we make sure that A, we know about that, and B, we get the right update into that piece of equipment? How does the equipment know that it's a valid update, not a bad guy trying to say, wait, you have a bug, here, I'll fix it, haha. So all of that stuff adds up to, this is hard. And that's why we need folks like you and your team to make sure that we get it, if not exactly right, at least more right